So my name is Rajshekhar and I will be your guide to the wonderful world of design patterns and in Python. The agenda is I will start a little bit about me, then we will move into what design patterns are, how design patterns are formed, basically what the components mean, then how they are classified. Since we are going to look at singleton and factory pattern, which forms the one of the creational patterns, we will be looking more into creational patterns, then go into how Python differs a bit in terms of implementation in design patterns due to the dynamic nature of Python. Then we will see how to implement singleton and factory patterns. And last but not least, we will have the QA session. So about me, I am PhD at Red Hat. I am a generalist, as I already said. That means I am not into just one technology or language. I have experience on multiple platforms, multiple technologies, including but not limited to Python, Java, .NET, C and C++. I have authored two books, one on how to develop Web 2.0 websites using Ruby on Rails, and there was a set of recipes for using .NET 4.5. This was basically advanced, it is for the advanced users. Apart from that, I also have written nearly 60 plus articles for DevShed portal. Again, this has been on multiple topics, including architectural designs, multiple languages, including Java and C++. I have been contributing to two main open source projects. First is Crane, which is the Docker management system for Pulp. Pulp is essentially repository management system, and Docker management system or Docker repository registry management is a part of it. Second is Gamedura. Gamedura is a platform where game designers, game developers, project managers can come together to develop games collaboratively. If you want to contact me, I am available at Twitter, which is @APRajshekhar, and my email is ap.rajshekhar@gmail.com. So first, what's design pattern? So design patterns was introduced by Gang of Four. If you have heard of Gang of Four, or if you had a chance to read Gang of Four, you will understand that design pattern is not just related to software. How Gang of Four came up with design patterns is that they looked at how carpenters work, how masons work, how they create the blueprint, how these blueprints are reused. Based on that, they came up with what we today know as design patterns. What design patterns are, in succinct, a general reusable solution to commonly occurring problems. The occurring problems could be anything, starting with how you create a particular object, to how you compose two objects to create a third new object, or how you pass messages between any of these objects. How design patterns are patterned basically is they have systematic names, they provide the motifs and explain the general design about how to address or how to mitigate recurring design problems. And please keep this in mind, this is specifically targeted towards object-oriented systems. Hence, most of the books or most of the patterns or examples that you see around the net would be targeted towards that rather than functional or any other type of programming. If I put it in another way, these are formalized best practices. Patterns are nothing but best practices. It doesn't just relate to software industry. Any industry, if you see, there are best practices for the tasks they perform. So any formalized best practices can be termed as a pattern, as a design pattern. How you go about understanding design pattern is that it describes the problem, solution, when to apply solution and its consequences. So let's say somebody comes and tells you that this is a design pattern. But if it does not tell you, does not describe the problem it is trying to solve, provide a solution for that particular problem, and when to apply, as well as its side effects. If these four things are not there, then you can't term it as a design pattern. It's just a best practice which has not yet been formalized. main thing you have to keep in mind is language neutral. That means anything that you write for Python can be implemented for Java or C++ or any of the other object-oriented application or language. And one major thing you have to keep in mind, not all problems require design patterns. Design patterns is kind of a hammer, and not all problems are nails, to use a well-known colloquialism. So now, what are the components of design patterns? There are four main parts of a design pattern. If you take up any design patterns, there are four main things that you will see. First is the name of the pattern, which is general because you have to refer it somehow. Second is the problem. That tells you where this should be applied basically, when you should start thinking about this using a particular design pattern. It will have a description, it will provide the context. Context is essential here because with respect to context, which design pattern you use may change. You may create an object using singleton, but with respect to, if the context changes, instead of singleton you may go ahead with abstract factory method. So context is very important here. Then there are scenarios. It gives you details about the scenarios in which you have to use it. Third part is solution. The solution basically tells how to implement or how to create the things in such a way, generalized form, that it will help you in solving that problem. The solution may be divided into multiple parts, hence I would turn them as elements. So what happens is that if a solution has multiple elements, then the design pattern will also talk about how these elements interact with each other and what is the responsibility of each of the element. In things like singleton pattern and simple factory pattern, there are no multiple elements, but more you go towards advanced design patterns, I shouldn't call them advanced, but I would say structural and behavioral design patterns, this comes into play more. Last but not the least are the consequences. When you are using a design pattern, there would be some results and there will be some trade-offs. So any design pattern should provide this as one of its core points. If you are using this design pattern, this would be the result. However, these would be the trade-offs. The trade-offs would be complexity, it could be space-time, it could be anything. So without providing these details, design patterns, a particular best practice cannot be termed as a design pattern. So how do you classify design patterns? At present there are above 50 plus design patterns available. So if you talk about bridge pattern, how would you classify? Where would it go? So the classification is done by intent. Intent means for what purpose this particular design pattern is used for. Is it used to create objects? Then it will come under creational patterns. Example is singleton and factory. Is it concerned with how the classes are composed, forming larger structures, or how these classes actually work with each other? That is structural patterns. Last is but not the least is a behavioral pattern. In this case, it is concerned with interaction and responsibility of object. This is where you see things like a method should only one thing, or how message is being passed between an object and another object. Should the message be in form of method calls? Should be in terms of some third party registry? So these all things come under behavioral patterns. For example, is command and observer. Observer is something that we see everyday use. A particular collection has been updated, you can add an observer to know how that collection, what is a new element. Or if I take operating systems itself, a file modifier has happened, you can get a message saying that this particular file has been modified, what do you want to? So all these things are not just at application program level, it even goes to system program level as well. since we will be talking about singleton and factory pattern, let's get more acquainted with creational patterns. As I said before, creational patterns are concerned with creation or instantiation of objects. How do you create an object? Should I create in such a way that only one instance should be there? Should I create in such a way that the client shouldn't know which subclass is being provided as the instance? Or should I create in such a way that the client doesn't even have to think about what instance is coming back, only that it can, he or she can use that instance and do whatever work needs to be done? So there are two dominant parts of creational patterns. First is to encapsulate the knowledge of concrete implementation. So let's say let's take example of database drivers. There are n number of database drivers at the moment. But if you say, let us say JDBC driver, you just need to know two or three things about a particular database system. Pass those details to JDBC class, it will give you the driver for that particular system without even you knowing which library has been called or what internally that has been done there to instantiate that particular driver class. Hiding the details of object creation. So again, let's take again example of database driver. You are trying to connect with MySQL. You pass the host port to it. Now you don't need to know how this host and port is being used to create the database driver. You just know that if you pass it to the JDBC class, it is a JDBC library, it will give you back an instance of driver which will contain all these details and which you can use to connect to MySQL. So that hides the details of object creation. It is further classified into object creational patterns, where the object itself would differ how part of it is created to another object. And the best example is again abstract factory, I would say, where factory itself would tell another object to create itself. Second is class creational patterns. This means this comes in terms of subclasses. So if you have a hierarchy of subclasses and you want to encapsulate which class is being created and how it is being created, that's where class creational pattern come into picture. So what are the well-known creational patterns? The well-known creational patterns are factory, singleton, abstract factory, builder, prototype. So factory, as I already told you, is part of the subclassing method. Then you have singleton. Then you have builder. Builder is where you defer the part of the creation to another object. Builder itself is not an object, but it internally tells another implementation to give whatever you require so that you can do your work. So that comes under object creation pattern. Coming to Python and design pattern. So essentially, design patterns were created at a time when C++ and Java were the main characters in the story of development, and both were in a way object oriented. So they were targeted towards object oriented systems which had certain and compilable by nature. So they had certain constraints there. However, when you come to dynamic languages, the best example is Python. There are certain things that change from how you implement a design pattern in terms of when you compare it with C or C++. So since Python is dynamic by nature, you can have certain extra work, extra freedom to do certain things, and that provides more flexibility. Third thing is, everything is public by default in Python. There is no private or protected. Yeah, there are name handling through which you can achieve private functionality. However, by default, everything is public. The last but not the least and the most important thing is that knowledge of magic or double underscore methods might be required. Because how Python instantiates an object, how Python creates an object, in what way you can make a class abstract. All these things comes under certain magical methods. So let's start with singleton pattern. What is the intent of singleton pattern? Its intent is to ensure that only one instance is created. It doesn't matter you are calling it twice or calling it 100 times. The same instance should be given back every time. Provide a application scoped access point for the object. So what does mean application scoped? Application scoped means there is only one instance throughout the lifecycle of the application. That is, there can be no more than one instance of it. Control concurrent access to shared resources. This is the other intent. So let us say you are writing a driver for printers, not just one printer, network printers. So you need to have a way to say that, okay, these printers, these number of printers are available at this moment. Okay, this printer has become busy, so only two are available now. So all these things has to be at a level where changes are visible to all the parts of the application, not just one part. And when you try to get a printer's instance, it should not create new instance every time. So this is where control concurrent access to shared resource comes into picture. What are the variants of a singleton? So when you create singleton, there are two ways you can create it. First is known as early initialization, that we will be looking at today. Second is known as lazy initialization. So in early initialization, whenever the application starts up, at that moment itself, the singleton objects are created and stored so that it can be used at any time. Lazy initialization means the instances are provided only when that particular the need arises. So let's take example of printer again. Your application is a word processor. So unless you click on printer, if it is lazy initialization, the printer class won't be initiated at all till that time. However, if you are implementing early instantiation, it would be initialized the moment your word processor application comes up. So what are the usages? So general usages is logging, caching, thread pools, configuration setting. So caching is something that I have worked recently, so I can give you a really good example. I had to create a Flask based application where cache needs to be had to be used by three different forms, three different controllers, and each of them should know exactly how many members are now available to be used or whether the cache has been refreshed or not. So in this instance, singleton was the best approach since it actually provides the current details at all times, and it kind of provide you a control over concurrent access of that particular cache. Then there are thread pools and configuration settings. So if you look at any of the configuration settings or any of the logging implementations, whether it is Python or whether it is Java, you will see they have one way or another they implement a singleton pattern there so that the control is always there and the current actual snapshot is visible to all the users of that particular library. So how do we implement it in Python? So we will be talking about eager initialization. Here comes the use of magic method. So whenever a Python object is created, the first magic method that gets called is underscore underscore new underscore underscore. This gets called when instance is being created, and this has the class's reference as the first object. So this reference can be used to customize how the object is being created. Now how do you implement, how do you use this particular reference to create a singleton object? Now the CLS, the class reference instance, has an attribute. So if that particular attribute is not set, then you can actually use the parents, that is objects underscore underscore new to set a new instance of the class. If it is set, return the value. Let's see how it looks like in code. So if you see, this is how you create a singleton class. You pass an object. It has to inherit from object. Then you override underscore underscore new underscore underscore. So it, the new underscore has the only one parameter CLF at this point for simplicity. What it checks is that whether CLS has an instance name, has an attribute named instance. So every CLS, every CLS object once instantiated will have an attribute named underscore underscore named instance, and it will be set to a particular value. That value would point to the ID of the object that has been created. So if that particular attribute is not set, we may call to the supers, that is objects new, and that will create this class and provide the ID. That ID then gets set to the instance attribute of CLS. Then you return the CLS instance. So the code is pretty simple, but internally it does a lot of things. First, it checks whether this particular object has been already created or not. So whenever you create a new object, IDs will be assigned to it. What it checks is that if an ID is already there or not. If that ID is there, it will be present in the attribute called instance. And if no ID is there, there won't be even an attribute called instance at all. That's the main reason we are checking hash attribute. Without that ID, the hash attribute won't be, the attribute instance won't be there at all. Once that comes, then you kind of delegate the creation of the new instance, the super. So if there is no attribute, create a new instance ID and give it to this class's instance. I'll tell you that, okay, this has been created. Once that is done, next time whenever this call is happening, it will find that the instance attribute is already there, so it will just return the instance attribute. So that's a peek into what singleton is and how singleton works. Let's now move to factory pattern. So what is the intent of a factory pattern? It is to ensure that a class is responsible for creating objects of other types. So let us take example of database drivers again. There can be multiple kinds of database drivers. One can be for MySQL, one can be for SQLite, another can be for DB2, but the client is not interested in knowing how they are instantiated. The client is only interested in getting an instance so that it can start talking to that particular database. The type of the object is based on parameters passed by one client. So client has to specify what it needs. So it can't just call factory pattern and say and think that automatically it will know what client needs. Client has to give parameters. For example, it has to say, okay, I want an instance of MySQL, and these are the details. So the factory pattern, factory class will create that and give it back to the client. Encapsulates the logic of object creation. Again, this is a creational pattern, so it has to encapsulate how that particular object has been created. Just like singleton, there are variants of factory pattern as well. First is simple factory pattern, second is factory method pattern, and third is abstract factory pattern. Today we will be talking about simple factory pattern. The main difference between all these three are, simple factory pattern is a class which basically takes parameter and provides you an instance of another class based on the parameter. Factory method is basically a method which takes the parameters, then based on the parameters apply certain logic in such a way that it can actually go and create a instance of subclass even of the required class. So whenever you want to provide a subclass reference which has more logic to it, then factory method is used. Abstract factory is when you want to create a completely different object from set of other patterns. This is a bit complex. We will be discussing in the future whenever possible. So usages are database driver and logging implementations. So how do you define a pattern? So let me tell you upfront, the simple factory pattern implementation that I'm going to talk is on uses Python 3.0, because Python 3.0 provides certain way to ensure abstract is abstract. Second part, it is not needed that you have to use abstract super class and then instant and then inherit from that, but it is a best practice where having an abstract super class helps in maintaining the laws or rules what needs to be done by the subclasses. So in Python 3, if you want to create an abstract class, you can create it using meta class called ABC meta. Now this is very really interesting thing. In Python, there are various meta classes available using which you can change how a particular class works. And ABC meta is where you use it to make the class abstract. Extend the abstract class and then implement the abstract method. This is the second step. And then define the factory class. Now the factory class is just a normal Python class. It has one method which takes the parameters corresponding to the subclass and returns the type of abstract class. So if this second point is optional, it only comes into picture if you are using hints. If you are not using type hints, then this point is not at all required. And then create and return the whatever has been created. So how does it works? You have abstract superclass. For that you have to first import ABC meta and abstract method from ABC. The example that I am showing you here is for let's say text representation of HTML. So HTML text can have multiple attributes, like it can have bold, it can have italics. So how do you create in such a way that by passing whether you want a bold or an italic, that particular class instance is returned to you. So first part is you are having a get HTML method is there and it is abstract. So the child classes have to implement them. So first is the bold class which inherits from text and then overrides it. So what it overrides, it says return, for brevity it just says return the bold tags. Similarly italics, it inherits from text. What it says, what it overrides and says is that it returns italics. Now this is the crux or the core of the complete logic. You have a text class factory and a method. What it takes is self and a type. Now since we are using the class names as with text, capitalized names, so to make sure that there is no instantiation error, we are just using the capitalization. So the target class name would be capitalized. So even if I send something like small bold, it will be capitalized to bold. So then return globals target class. So what it does is basically this particular class is already there, and from that you are saying that from the globals find this particular name and create it and give it back. So example is you have a text factory, create a text factory, then you are asking for the bold. So if you print it out, you will get this one. So that's an overview of how factory pattern can be implemented in Python. So that completes my presentation. Any queries, questions?
That was a great talk. Thank you so much, AP. So there is one question from Akshay.
Okay.
So he asked that when one should think about using design patterns in a project.
Okay, that is a really great question. So the thumb rule that I use is, if your application is just two or three files, or doesn't have, each file doesn't have more than 20 lines, then you don't have to think about design patterns. But let us say you are creating a project which talks to multiple systems, which has to talk to database servers, which has to provide validation functionalities. In such cases, you have to start thinking about design patterns, because what you may start writing as a simple project may evolve into a very complex structure. So thinking about design patterns from upfront will help you in reducing, in making it more maintainable. I hope that answers the question.
There is a next question by Akshay again. Singleton pattern is similar to static class in Python. Is it similar to
So it's not completely, because static class has a different. Okay, let me put it this way. Singleton, you can use static class instead of singleton in certain cases. But if you want to actually control how you are sharing the resources, so as I told you, there is one more way to initialize the object, and there is one more part to the design singleton design patterns, where it controls the sharing of resources. If your implementation doesn't need sharing of resources, doesn't need to control the sharing of resources, then you can go for static method, static class. But if the implementation needs to control how each shared resource is being used, how many instances are available at present, can I give one to another person, then singleton is the best way to go. Hope that helps.
There are a few more questions. Let me relay those to you. Give me a second. So the next question is from Udayendu. So he is asking, when starting a project, how to start thinking about the design pattern as we keep on adding features time to time? AP, I guess you are muted.
Am I audible now?
Yes, you are. Okay. So are you able to see my screen by any chance?
No.
Okay, let me repeat the question. So okay. Udayendu is asking, when starting a project, how to start thinking about the design pattern as we keep on adding features time to time?
Okay, so design, you don't need to start with design patterns at the early onset of project itself. It's a requirement, doesn't call for it. As I already said, design patterns are hammers, and not all solutions, all problems are nails. So if your requirement doesn't have anything like database, connectivity, concurrent control, or caching, in that case, you don't even have to think about design patterns. You can start the way you are doing any other project. But let us say, after first iteration, any requirement comes where you need to have any of these, then you can actually start. You don't need to refactor existing code. You can actually start a complete other part where you can implement the design patterns and start using it. So that is the beauty of design pattern as well. You can actually decouple the way you are creating or implementing stuff. I hope that answers the query.
Yeah, so the last question is from Anand. He's asking, any specific scenario or problem statements which we must or should follow the such design patterns?
Didn't get you.
Okay. Any specific scenario or problem statement where we must follow such design patterns?
Okay. So on the top of my head, I would say, if the requirement says we need to have caching, I would say we need design patterns. If it says we have to have control over, we are having three files and we want to do it in such a way that at a time only one person can access the file, you need design pattern. You are having a UI where there are multiple threads are working and backend calls happen on that, you need design pattern. In such cases, you will need design patterns. Hope that helps.
Let me see if there are any other questions. No. So Akshay and Udayendu are saying thank you. They got the answer to their questions.
Anytime.
Thank you so much, AP, for joining us, delivering an awesome talk.
Thank you.